بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I would like to welcome you all to our 20th lecture in Microbiology Made Easy series. In this lecture, I will be covering part 8 of bacterial genetic. Part 8 will be the last part in our lectures on bacterial genetic. In part 8 of bacterial genetic, I will be talking and covering the second component of bacterial genetic variation, which is mobile genetic elements. In this lecture, I will be covering and talking about two mobile genetic elements. The first one is the transposons, and the second one is the integrons. Please don't forget to share this lecture with your friend and colleagues in order to obtain the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the previous two slides, we have discussed genetic variation in bacteria. And as I have stated previously, in regard to genetic variation in bacteria, we have mutation, which we have covered in the previous slide. And the second component in genetic variation of bacteria is what we call it mobile genetic elements, or the other name for these mobile genetic elements, we call them transposons. Transposons. So what is transposons? Transposons, they are a DNA segments. So you see here in this cartoon or in this diagram, we have DNA A in black color, which you see it here. We have DNA B in gray color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And then we have the transposons in green color, which I'm pointing at them with my laser pointer. So what is transposons? Transposons, they are a segments or certain DNA segments. So what we have here in green color is a certain DNA segment. This is a double-stranded DNA segment, which you see it here in green color, which is located within the bacterial chromosome in black color. These transposons, which you see them in green color, they have the ability to jump from one bacterial cell DNA into another bacterial cell is DNA. So it means that these transposons, we see them in a green color, they can jump from the DNA of bacterial A in black into the DNA of bacterial B in green color, as you see here in this diagram. So here you can see it here. The black color DNA is the, we call it DNA A. I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So DNA A is the black color DNA. Inserted inside it is we have transposon in green color. Bacterial DNA B, they are in green color, which I'm pointing at them now with my laser pointer. So then what will happen is these transposons, which is a segment of DNA, will be jumping from the DNA A into DNA B. And then once they jump this transposons in green color, they will jump and then they will insert themselves into the DNA of the DNA B in gray color. So then what will happen is, after this insertion, we have the bacterial DNA B in gray color. I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. It has acquired inside it is transposon in a green color. And then the other bacteria, which is in black color, which is bacteria, which is the DNA A, you see it here as well, inside it remain the transposon. So the transposon will be jumping from bacterial DNA A into the bacterial DNA B, and then a copy of this transposon will remain in the bacterial DNA A, and a copy of it will be jumping into the bacterial DNA B. So this is the B in gray color, and inside you can see the transposon. Now, this transposon in the DNA A If this transposon codes for genes that will make this bacteria resistant to antibiotic or a certain type of antibiotic, so then when this transposon from the DNA A will be jumped into the DNA B, so then the bacterial with DNA B will become resistant to this antibiotic as well. So this is what we call it, the transposons. Now the question which we need to answer in this slide is how the transposons, which is a segment of a DNA as I have mentioned in the previous slide, insert themselves into the recipient DNA. So what you see here in this slide, we have, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, we have the donor DNA. So we have double-stranded DNA here, okay? I'm pointing at them with my laser pointer. Inside them, we have the transposon in black color. You see the black color? These two? These are the transposons. The donor DNA, we have two strands, double strands. This is the first strand, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And this is the complementary strand, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. The same thing with the transposon, it has a double-stranded DNA, which you see it here in dark black color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So this is the transposon inside the donor DNA. As I mentioned in the previous slide, for example, DNA A, which contains the transposon, and then it's going to donate this transposon. The donor DNA is going to donate this transposon into the recipient DNA in bacterial B, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and you can see the double-stranded in red color. So this is the recipient DNA in bacteria B, for example. And this is the donor DNA with the transposon in bacteria A. Okay, so how this segment of the transposon will be moved from bacterial A or the donor bacterial into the recipient bacterial, which is bacterial B, or we see it here with its DNA in red color. We have an enzyme, we call it transposase, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. See here, transposase. So this is the enzyme. What this enzyme will do, this enzyme will create or will cause a nex at the three end of the transposons on one DNA strand and another nick on the five end of the transposon in the other strand. So what that mean? You see here the black arrow. So let's see. This is, you see the black arrow here, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So the transposase enzyme will come and will make a neck here, an opening here, which pointed at with the black arrow. And I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. So it will create an opening here in one strand, at which is, we call it, this is the 3 prime, okay, which this is the 3 prime, and this is the 5 prime of the DNA. So then the transposase will create a nick or an opening at the 3 prime end of this strand and create another nick or opening, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, at the 5 prime end of the other strand of the donor DNA from bacteria A. Then what will happen after that? The same enzyme, which is the transposase, it will go and create a nick in here, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, in the recipient DNA at the 5 prime in here, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and then it creates another nick where the black arrow is pointed at the 5, at the 3 prime of the other DNA strand of the recipient bacteria or of the recipient DNA in bacterial B. Then what will happen after that? Then this transposon, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, which is dark and black, it will go and insert itself into the recipient DNA. So the transposon, which you see here, I'm pointing at with my laser pointer in black color, it will come and after cutting with the transposase, it will insert itself into the recipient DNA. So here you see the transposons in black color inserted in the recipient DNA in red color. Okay? So then what will happen is, this is the transposase, this is the transposon, sorry, in black color, double-stranded, inserted in the red color of the recipient DNA. The insertion of the transposon in black color into the recipient DNA in red color will create a gap in here, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, and another gap in here. So the gap in the first strand, and then another gap in the complementary strand. These gaps will be filled, as you see here, with this. You see the blue arrow? So this is indication the filling of the gap. The DNA will replicate and will fill these gaps. So this will result in the transposon in black color, which I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, are inserted in the red color DNA of the recipient, as you see here. So then what we will have is, we will have the transposon, which is this one. I'm circling around it with the red color. See, this is the transposon from the donor DNA are inserted into the DNA of the recipient DNA. I'm pointing at the recipient DNA with the green color pen. Okay? So then, let's say, for example, if this transposon in the donor DNA, which as I mentioned, obtained from bacterial A, is making bacterial A resistant to penicillin. The recipient is sensitive to penicillin. The recipient bacteria with the red DNA is sensitive to penicillin. However, after the transposon will get inserted into the DNA of the bacterial B, or after the transposon from bacterial A are inserted into the DNA of the recipient bacteria, which bacterial B, then bacterial B will become resistant to penicillin as well. So that indicates that these transposons are important. Why? Because it can make bacteria resistant to certain types of antibiotic. The transposons, they have the capability to move from the plasmid, which you see here. You see here we have a plasmid, okay? And then we have, I'm going to get it with my laser pointer. This is the transposon inserted in the, we have the transposon, for example, you see it here. This is the transposon, which I'm circling around it with the green color, inserted in the bacterial plasmid. This transposon can jump from the plasmid into the chromosome of the bacterial cell, as I'm showing here. You see? And then you can see the transposon, as I have stated previously, by using the transposase enzyme, it will insert itself into the chromosome of the bacterial cell. So, the transposon can jump from bacterial plasmid into the chromosome of the bacterial cell, or vice versa. Transposon also can jump from the chromosome of the bacterial cells back into the cytoplasm. If we look at the classification of transposons, on the basis of their transposition mechanism, transposons can be divided or categorized into different types. The first type of transposon, we call it replicative transposon, and the second one we call it non-replicative transposon, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer, or also we can call it cut and paste transposon. So what's the difference between replicative transposon and cut and paste transposon? Replicative transposon, it means that the transposon will leave a copy of itself at the original location. So it means that this is a doubling copies of transposon. So what that mean? What we have here is, which I'm going to get with my laser pointer, we have the donor DNA. You see the donor DNA double strand. So this is strand one, this is the second strand. You can see the transposon in black color inside the donor DNA. Okay? Then what will happen is this transposon will make a copy of itself. You see it here? So now we have a synthesis of a DNA copy of the transposon. So the transposon producing a copy of itself, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer. Then this newly synthesized transposon will go into the DNA of another bacterial cell, and then it will insert itself into the DNA or the recipient DNA from another bacterial cell. So it means that, again, we have a bacterial cell A which contain the DNA, and this DNA contain the transposon in black color. So let's say this is the transposon in the DNA of the bacterial A. This transposon will synthesize a copy of itself, okay? And then this newly synthesized transposon will be inserting itself, as I'm pointing out with my laser pointer, into the DNA of bacterial cell B. So this is, we call it, the DNA of the bacterial cell B, we call it recipient DNA. Okay? Then the transposon, will go into the, inside the, as I mentioned, the DNA of the recipient bacterial cell, which is bacteria B. Okay? Then, the end, we will have the recipient DNA with the transposon inside it, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer. And then also, the donor DNA, it still has the transposon inside it. So, the end, we will have the donor DNA with the transposon and the recipient DNA as well with the same transposon. Okay? And then the recipient DNA, if this transposon in the donor DNA make this bacteria resistant to antibiotic, then the bacterial B, after receiving this transposon in its DNA, then this bacterial B will become resistant to this antibiotic. This is, we call it replicative transposon. So what that mean? It means that in replicative transposon, the transposon will leave a copy of itself in the original location. So here, the original location, the transposon, it has a copy of itself. And also, he gave a copy to the recipient. So the copy of itself remain in the donor DNA, and then a copy of this transposon will go to the bacterial B, as I have mentioned previously. The second type of the transposon, we call it non-replicative transposon. Non-replicative transposon, it means that the transposon from the donor cell does not leave a copy of itself in the donor DNA. So it's different from the replicative transposon. So here what we have is, as I'm going to get with my laser pointer, we have the donor DNA with the transposon in dark black color. Okay? Then what we will have here is, we have accession of the transposon. So a piece of the transposon has been cut off from the donor DNA. Then this excised piece of the transposon, or this piece of the cut of the transposon, or the piece that has been cut off from the transposon, will go into the recipient DNA. Okay? Then what will happen is, as I pointed with my laser pointer, so it will have the recipient DNA with the transposon. However, the donor DNA has lost this piece of the transposon. So it means that the donor DNA did not leave a copy of the transposon in its DNA. So the donor DNA lost a piece of the transposon. And this is not the case in the replicative transposon. Why? Because in the replicative transposon, the transposon leaves a copy of itself at the original location at the donor DNA. However, in the non-replicative transposon, the transposon does not leave a copy of itself in the original donor DNA. So this is the difference between replicative and non-replicative transposons. This is a slide summarizing what I have stated and described in the previous slides regarding the transposons. So, in recent years, it has been recognized that the arrangement of genes in the genome of the bacteria are not entirely static. So, what that means? It means that the genes or in the genome of the bacteria, they are mobile. They can move. They are not static. What that means? It means that certain DNA segments, we call them transposons, they have the ability to move from one place to another place on the chromosome and into the out of the plasmid, as I have described previously. Also, transposons, they don't exist as a segment free of the genome, but they are integrated into the bacterial genome. And as I mentioned in the previous slide, we have two types of transposons. We have replicative transposons, as I have described, which leave a copy of itself at the original location. Thus, it's doubling copies of transposon. And the second type, as I have described in details in the previous slide, we have non-replicative transposons, and this is the one which it does not leave a copy of itself at the original location. In this diagram, we can see that the transposon in orange color, so this is in yellow color here, we have the bacterial plasmid, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. Now, in the bacterial plasmid, in orange color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, we have the transposon in orange color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. If we magnify this transposon, we're going to see that the transposon DNA consists of three different genes. The first gene, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer in blue color or dark blue color, is we call it transposase. The second gene, we call it resolvase, which you can see it here in red color, and I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. These two genes, transposase, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and resolvase, are responsible, these two genes and corresponding protein are responsible for the movement of the transposon from the bacterial chromosome into the plasmid, or from one bacterial chromosome, which is the donor, into the DNA of another bacteria, which we call it recipient DNA. The other gene in the transposon, we call it antibiotic resistant gene, which you can see it here in green color, and I'm pointing at it with my laser pointer. Also, you can see here in this diagram, as I mentioned previously, we have the bacterial chromosome in yellow color. Inside it, we have the transposon in orange color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And you can see that transposon can jump from the bacterial chromosome into the plasmid. You can see here, transposon jumping from the bacterial chromosome into the plasmid. So this is the plasmid. And also, the transposon can jump from the plasmid back into the bacterial chromosome. Also, you can see here in this diagram that the transposon can jump from one place in bacterial chromosome into the another place within the same bacterial chromosome, as I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and then it can jump again from one place in bacterial chromosome, as I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and following the black arrow into another place in the bacterial chromosome, as indicated by the black arrow. In this slide, we can see, or it summarizes what I have stated in the previous slide, that the transposon has three different genes: transposase, resolvase, as I'm pointing at with this red dot, and that these two genes, transposase and resolvase, code for the enzymes that they are involved in the transposition process or the movement of the transposon from, for example, bacterial chromosome into bacterial plasmid. The third gene of the transposon is the antibiotic resistant gene. Now, what is stated here that when transposon inserts itself into the recipient DNA, this will result in a mutation in the recipient DNA. So what that mean? It means that, let's say for example, this is the, I'm drawing now the transposon in red color, okay? And this transposon present where? In the donor DNA. So this is the donor DNA. So what we have here in red color, this is the transposon. So now, when the transposon insert itself in the recipient DNA, so then what will happen is this transposon in red color, which I'm pointing at with this purple dot, so the transposon in red color will insert itself into the recipient DNA, as I'm pointing with the arrow. So then what will happen is, so we'll have the transposon here. You see it here, I'm drawing it now. This is the transposon in red color, inserted in the recipient DNA. The insertion of the transposon in the recipient DNA will change the nucleotide sequence of the DNA in the recipient. So what that means is, it means that because the transposon inserted from the donor DNA into the recipient DNA, so then the DNA sequence will be changed. DNA sequence in here, it will be changed. So this will result in the mutation of the recipient DNA. Also, don't forget that if this transposon in the recipient DNA is making this bacteria resistant to antibiotics, so this when this transposon move into the donor DNA, so then this donor DNA as well will become resistant to this antibiotic. So then we can say that transposon are very important in the spread of antibiotic resistant genes, which will result in the emerging of antibiotic resistant bacteria. That's why transposons are very important for us as a microbiologist. Now, I'm going to talk about an important mobile bacterial genetic element. We call them integrons. So what is the meaning of integrons? Integrons, as I have stated previously, they are mobile bacterial genetic elements that have the capability to promote the acquisitions of gene embedded in the cassettes or gene cassettes. Usually, integrons are widely distributed, especially you find them in gram-negative bacteria. These integrons These integrons, or these mobile genetic elements, usually you find them where? In bacterial plasmid, and you find them in the bacterial transposons. I have described bacterial plasmid and transposons previously. However, integrons, you find them within the bacterial plasmid and in the transposons. The presence of integrons in bacterial plasmid and the transposons will allow or will facilitate the transfer of integrons through the plasmid or transposons from the genome or from the bacterial chromosome of bacterial A, for example, into another bacteria or into the chromosome of bacterial B. So it means that the presence of integrons in plasmid and the transposons promote their spread within the bacterial communities. Why? Because the presence of integrons in bacterial plasmid or transposons will facilitate the movement of these integrons through the plasmid and plasmid through the conjugation from a bacterial cell to another. Or the presence of integron on transposons will facilitate the transfer, as I mentioned previously, or the jump of these transposons which carry the integrons from one bacterial chromosome into the other. Now we have two major groups of integrons. The first one we call it chromosomal integrons. These ones, from the name, integrons, that they are located where? On the chromosomes. And usually we find them in hundreds of bacterial species. So many bacterial species carry chromosomal integrons. Sometimes these chromosomal integrons, we call them super integrons, or abbreviation SIS. Usually these chromosomal integrons can carry up to 200 gene cassette, and they code for protein that we don't know their function yet. The second group of integrons, we call them mobile integrons, abbreviation is MIS, and usually they are not self-transposable element, so they cannot transfer or transport by themselves. However, because they are located on plasmid and on the transposons, so then integrons can get transported through the transposons or by the transposons and the plasmid from one bacterial cells into another. Usually mobile integrons contain about 10 gene cassettes. However, as I mentioned previously, chromosomal integrons contains up to 200 gene cassettes. Usually the gene cassettes that we find them in the mobile integrons, and as I mentioned that mobile integrons are carried by transposons or plasmid, they encode for what? They encode for antibiotic resistance. So the gene cassettes of the integrons that we find them in the plasmid or transposons, they carrying gene responsible for making the bacteria resistant to different antibiotics. That's why we call them resistant integrons or multidrug resistant integrons. In the previous slide, I have talked to you about mobile genetic elements, which we call them integrons. And I have stated that integrons, they are mobile bacterial genetic elements that able to promote the acquisition of genes embedded in the cassette. So what that mean? In order to understand the definition of integrons, I'm going to explain to you the structure of the integron. So, usually integrons is based on what we call it functional platform. This functional platform, we also call it 5' conserved segment. So here 5', which I'm pointing at, and then CS, which is abbreviation for conserved segment. So now, if we look here, in this diagram, here we have the functional platform of the integron, which I am circling around it with my red pen. This is the functional platform of the integron. And what you see here in the blue color, what we call it, the gene cassette. So this is the gene cassette. You see the gene cassette in blue color. Now, the integron functional platform, or generally integron, composed of three key elements. The first key element, we call it initial I gene or I intel gene, which I am underlining now. So the intel or initial I gene, if you look at the diagram, you see it here, this is the initial I gene. So here we have the initial I gene in a black color in the function or the functional platform of the integron. I'm pointing at it with my red point. So this is the initial I gene or I intel I gene of the integron. The function of the I intel gene of the integron, it codes for an enzyme, we call it integrase. This integrase enzyme is a member of a family of enzymes, we call it tyrosine recombinase. The function of tyrosine recombinase is to cut the integron at an attachment or recombination site, we call it ATTI. I am now drawing a circle around the ATTI. You see, this is the ATTI. So this triangle, which I'm pointing at with my red dot, this triangle here, this is the second key element of the integron. We call it a specific recombination site, a specific recombination site, or ATTI. ATTI. Okay? So here we have the second key element of the functional platform of the integron, which we call it a specific recombination site, or you see it here in the gray color, as appear as triangle shape. We call it ATTI. ATT stands for, is an abbreviation for attachment. Then the third key element, of the integron, we call it the promoter or PC. So this is, you see it here, this is the PC. I'm drawing a green circle around the BC or the promoter of the integron. Okay? So this is a diagram summarized to you what the integrons look like. What we have stated in the previous slide, that integrons are mobile bacterial genetic element that able to promote the acquisition of genes embedded in the cassette or gene cassette. So what is the meaning of gene cassette? What you see here in this diagram, this is the gene cassette in blue color, which I'm pointing at with my red dot. So this is the gene cassette. This is the gene cassette in blue color. This gene cassette, it has an attachment site. We call it ATTC. So this is attachment site present on the gene cassette. We call it ATTC. Usually, this gene cassette are made from non-repetitive mobile or non-repetitive DNA sequence. Some of these gene cassettes are code for antibiotic resistance. So the acquisition of this gene cassette will make the bacteria resistant to antibiotic. How bacteria will acquisite or obtain this gene cassette into its bacterial chromosome or into its plasmid or transposons? This happens through the integrons. Through the integrons. So, what you see here in this diagram, as I have described previously, this is the key. This diagram shows the key elements of the integrons. So, in addition to the gene cassette, we have the INTI, which I'm drawing a circle around it. This is INTI, which you see it here as a black arrow. This INTI, which is a gene, this INTI will code for an enzyme we call it integrase. Enzyme we call it integrase. Sorry about my handwriting. Integrase. I'm drawing using a mouse, so it's not easy. Integrase. So now, the INTI. So INT is abbreviation for integron. I is an abbreviation for integrase enzyme. This enzyme, which is integrase, is a member of the tyrosine recombinase family. The function of this enzyme will cut the integron at the attachment site ATTI. This is the ATTI attachment site. You can see it here appear as in triangle shape. This triangle shape, we call it ATTI site. ATT is an abbreviation for attachment. So this is attachment site I or ATTI. So what will happen? Integrase will cut the integron here at this attachment site. So the cutting will be where? Here. So then integrase will come and cut the integron at this site. Okay? Then the integrase, the enzyme, it will drag the gene cassette, which is the one in blue color. It will drag the gene cassette, which is in blue color. As I have stated previously, I'm pointing at it with my red dot. And the integrase will drag and bring this gene cassette and insert the gene cassette in here, as I'm drawing with my red arrow. So this will result in what? This will result what you see here in this diagram. You see this black arrow? If you follow it, you can see now the gene cassette, which is in blue color, as I have described previously, are already inserted in front of the ATTI attachment site. So this is the gene cassette. So this gene cassette, this gene cassette in blue color, you see it here? It got, under the influence of the integrase enzyme, it got inserted into the integrons, as I'm pointing with my red arrow, in front of the ATTI attachment site. And who cut the ATTI attachment site and was the integrase enzyme? So the integrase cut the ATTI, that's number one, and then the integrase dragged this gene cassette and then inserted it in front of this ATTI site, as you see here. So this is the ATTI site, and this is the gene cassette already inserted in the integron functional platform. Before I forget, you can see, as I mentioned previously, that the integron, it contains a number of gene cassettes. So you see here, this is the integron. So here we have, this is the integron. We have gene cassette 1 and gene cassette 2. They already exist in the integrons. And then here we have inserted, under the influence of integrase, we have inserted another gene cassette, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. So then, before, we used to have gene cassette 1 and gene cassette 2 in the integron, as I'm pointing with my laser pointer. So before the insertion, we had gene cassette 1 or GC1, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer, and GC2. Then after that, as I have mentioned previously, under the influence of the integrase, we have inserted another gene cassette, shown in the blue color, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. We have inserted it into the integron. So then, before, we used to have two gene cassettes in the integron, which I'm pointing at with my laser pointer. And then after that, or now, we are having three gene cassettes in the integron. We have the new gene cassette, which is in blue color, which I am pointing at with my laser pointer. In addition to that, we have the gene cassette 1 and the gene cassette 2. Okay? Now, as I mentioned previously, that if this gene cassette codes for protein that will make bacteria resistant to antibiotics, so then what will happen is the insertion of this gene cassette into this integron means that this one or this integron will result in the acquisition of antibiotic resistant gene. So this will make the bacteria more resistant to another or to new antibiotic. This is just to show you the diagram without any of my handwritings, just for the clarification of the diagram and for your information. As I have stated in the previous slide in regard to the integrons, so I said that the first key component of the functional platform of the integron, we have the INTI. This is the INTI, which you see here in blue color. And I said that INT stands for integron, and I stands for an enzyme, we call it integrase. Then, the second key component of the functional platform of the integron, we have the promoter, or the PC, which I'm drawing a red circle around. So this is the PC, or the promoter. Then after the promoter, we have the attachment site, or the recombination site, we call it ATTI. And as I have stated previously, ATT is an abbreviation for attachment, and I for integron. Then after that, we have, after the ATTI, we have gene cassette 1, which is GC1. Then after the GC1, we have another attachment site, we call it ATTC1. So this is another attachment site. And then after the ATTC1, we have another gene cassette, we call it GC2. This is GC2. Then after the GC2, gene cassette 2, we have another recombination site or attachment site, we call it ATTC2. Okay. Then what I have stated, that the INTI, or which is an abbreviation for integron, and INT is an abbreviation for integron, and I is an abbreviation for integrase. So what that means? That it means that the NITI site will produce the, or will code for the integrase enzyme. Integrase enzyme. And you remember, this is the integrase. Sorry about my handwriting. So this is the integrase. Integrase enzyme. And then what I said about integrase enzyme, we said that integrase enzyme is a member of a family. We call it tyrosine recombinase. The function of this enzyme integrase is to cut the integron at the, where? at DATTI attachment site, which is this one, or recombination site. So this is the function of integrase. The first function is to create a cut in here. Okay? Then after that, what will happen is, then you see the gene cassette in here. This is gene cassette. We call it GC3. You see this gene cassette? Okay? This gene cassette, GC3, which is responsible, for example, for antibiotic resistance, this gene cassette will be dragged by the integrase into here. So, this gene cassette in red color, which I'm pointing at with my green dot, this is the gene cassette, it will be dragged and inserted by the integrase into here. At the ATTI attachment or recombination site. So the result will be, you see it here, this is the GC3, this is the gene cassette, GC3 is already inserted in the integron. So if you compare between these two pictures, this second picture, this is number one, let's say this is number one, and this is number two. So you can see the difference between diagram two in comparison to one. In one, we have INTI, promoter, attachment site, and then we have the GC or gene cassette one. However, in the number two picture, what we have is, we have the GC3 gene cassette, this one, has been inserted in front of the ATTI recombination, or inserted at, sorry, ATTI attachment site. Please don't forget that gene cassette 3 has been inserted in front of the promoter, in front of the promoter. So as I mentioned previously, it means that the RNA polymerase will attach to this promoter, and then it can transcribe and translate the genes of the GC3 or of the gene cassette 3, and this will result in the production of protein or maybe enzymes like beta-lactamase, which will make this bacterial resistant to antibiotic like penicillin. Also, what I want you to know from this slide, you see here that we have inserted GC3 or the gene cassette 3 has been inserted into the integron. Also, integron can lose gene cassettes, like what you see here. You see here, now we have this one, we have gene cassette 1. You see it here? I'm drawing a red circle around it. Now, you can see that the gene cassette 1 has been lost. It's not lost, but it has been excised out from the integron. You see, this is now GCI, or GC1, sorry. Gene cassette 1 has been excised out from the integron. Okay? Now, as you see that the gene cassette, when it's inside the integron, it's linear, straight line, as I'm pointing at with my red dot. However, outside the integron, the gene cassette will become, goes into a circle. Okay? And you can see here the attachment site of the gene cassette, which is the ATTC1, which is this one. Now, this gene cassette can go, and this gene cassette 1, this one, it can go, and it can insert itself into the integron or into another integron in the same bacterial cell or in another bacterial cell. And then it can be carried as well from one bacterial cell into another bacterial cell by the plasmid. Now, after the integron functional platform lost, or the GC1 got excised out of it, what we'll have is, we will have picture number 3. So what we'll have is INTI site, the promoter, ATTI attachment site, and then after that the GC3 or the gene cassette 3, which has been recently inserted under the influence of the integrase enzyme. But here we have no more GC1, which you see it in picture number 2. is not here anymore. It has been taken out, excised out. And then, as I mentioned, that now this gene cassette 1 or GC1, which I'm waiting at with my red dot, it will go into maybe into insert itself into the integron of the same bacterial chromosome or into another bacterial chromosome or into bacterial plasmid, and the cycle will continue. And this will make the bacteria will acquiring virulence genes and corresponding proteins, and one of these virulence genes that will make this bacteria resistant to antibiotics, which I have described in the previous slide. But here I'm showing it to you without any labeling or handwriting, just for further clarification. At the end of this lecture, which I have talked about the bacterial genetic elements with special reference to transposons and integrons, I can say that we have finished our series of lectures on the bacterial genetic. Inshallah, my next lecture will be on antibiotics. However, before concluding this lecture, please don't forget to share this lecture with your friend and colleagues in order to obtain the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank you.